In this segment, we'll move on to looking at the assemble system function for the homework 4 template. So let's look at that code now. You'll notice first off, we have two new objects. We have this FE values and FE face values. These objects are DL2 objects that hold information about the basis functions, the basis function gradients, information about the quadrature points, the Jacobians, and all this. So we no longer have to calculate the Jacobians, we don't have to write out the basis functions themselves. We don't have to write out the quadrature points. It does all that for us, all right? So if you look, the first two input values are just FE and quadrature formula, so that it knows what basis function order we're using, and it knows what quadrature rule we are using. The third input value is actually a series of input values of flags that tell DL2 or the tell FE values what information we're going to be using, and that's the information that it will be updating. So it makes it a little bit faster or saves on memory that we don't need to update information that we won't actually be using. All right, so for FE values, which is what we use for volume integrals, we're going to be updating the values, which are the values of the basis functions, update gradients, that's again the basis function gradients, and then this JXW, that's supposed to be like J times W. J stands for the determinant of the Jacobian, and W stands for the quadrature weights. So it's all three quadrature weights multiplied together in 3D. All right, so it takes care of all of that for us. The values and the gradients we would use, the gradients we use in K-local, the values we would use in F-local if we had a body force, okay? And of course, J times W we would use in any volume integral. If we move on to FE face values, we'll see I'm updating values, quadrature points, and J times W values. J times W values is as before. Only now you'll notice, since it's a surface integral, it'll be the determinant of the Jacobian mapping from the 2D biunit domain to the 2D surface domain, right? Update values is, of course, still the basis function value on that surface. Update quadrature points, this actually will give you the position vector of each quadrature point in the real domain. All right, so we need that in this problem because the traction for our Neumann bounding condition depends on the x1 component. Okay, so it varies as x1 varies on that Neumann surface of z equals 1. Okay, so that's why we're updating those values. So let's scroll down into our element loop. Now you can see here the first thing is that we do fevalues.reinitElem. So fevalues is reinitializing for this particular element. So it's getting all the correct values for the quadrature, for the Jacobians, and so on. The first step that we're going to look at is defining K-local. Now before we look any further at the code, let's look at the board at what that general form is. Okay? So in class, in the lectures, we looked at K-local, and we had four indices that we were dealing with, K-local A, B, I, J. And the idea was that A, B run over the nodes in your element, okay? So I'd go from 0 up to just less than the number of nodes in the element. Okay, I and J are nodal degrees of freedom, and so that will run up from 0, 1, and 2 in this case for the 3D elasticity. All right, and the way we pictured that is that we had our K-local matrix, and then inside we had these little submatrices, right? And so, again, there are 8 nodes in a hexahedral element, And so these went from 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 7. Right, same on the side, 0, 1 to 7. Now within these submatrices, we had indices 0, 1, 2. 0, 1, 2. Those correspond to the degrees of freedom at that particular node. Okay? Now, of course, K-local is, it's not a matrix of matrices in DL2, it's just a matrix that's 24 by 24. All right, so we can look at this instead. Just make that as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on, up to 21, 22, 23. Okay, so let me label these. These would be our element degrees of freedom here, going from 0 to 23. Then we have our element nodes, here, going from 0 to 7. And then we have our nodal degrees of freedom, here, going from 0 to 2, 0, 1, and 2. All right? So you'll notice when we look at the code again that our loops are actually looping over the element nodes and the nodal degrees of freedom. However, the indices in K-local will be in terms of the element degrees of freedom. Okay, so how do we do that conversion? Because the indices start at 0, it actually makes it simpler in this case. So we would do it like this. K-local ABIJ corresponds to 3 times A plus I, comma 3 times B plus J. I guess I should do square brackets on both of those. Right? And you can see that that's true. Let's go to the, let's do it for 22 here. So that would be A is equal to 7, so 3 times 7 is 21. The nodal degree of freedom would be 1 at that point. So 21 plus 1 gives us an element degree of freedom of 22. Okay. And we'll work the same way for F local. For F local, it'll be F local A sub I would be the same as F local of 3 times A plus I. We'll look at that again in a second. Okay. Now let's look at how we actually calculate K-local ABIJ. So let me write out the formula here. So we have K-local ABIJ is equal to the integral over the domain of the element, basis function A, the derivative with respect to x sub j, our elasticity tensor CIJKL times our basis function B, comma L dV. All right, and notice we have repeated indices here. So there is an implied summation over J and L. For J and L going from 0, 1, and 2. Okay. All right. So let's look at what that will be in our note, in our code over here. All right, so first off, in our loops, we have a loop over quadrature points. Notice it's a single loop over quadrature points. DL2 has combined all three loops, since this is a 3D case, into a single loop. All right, and it's keeping track of that for us. Now we have our loop over A and I, which is the loop over nodes A, and then loop over nodal degrees of freedom. B and K, again, looping over element nodes and element or nodal degrees of freedom. Now actually, I need to come back here and make a small change that I noticed. That's actually not the way I've written it here. That's not for k-local abij. It's actually for k-local abik. And the reason you should be able to see that is because j has already been removed through the summation. I and k are the free variables here. And so that's what should show up in k-local, in the indices of k-local, all right? So that's why I have a and I grouped together, then b and k, j and l. We have a loop there because of the implied summation over j and l, okay? And now in here, you'll define k-local using, of course, this integral that we've written out. Now, one thing that's important for you to know is that when we use FE values to get the gradient, which we do using FE values dot shape grad, it's actually giving us the gradient with respect to x in the real domain. You'll notice in the previous assignments when we wrote the basis gradient functions, the basis function gradients, we wrote the gradient with respect to xi in the biunit domain. And then we had to find the Jacobian, do the inverse, and so on, right? That's all taken care of here. Okay, so we don't have to deal with the Jacobian in order to make that a gradient with respect to the real domain. That's already done for us. Okay, so in order to access that gradient, you do fevalues.shapegrad, and then you'd input the element degree of freedom. Okay, now notice that's a little bit different than what we've written on the board here. In the lectures, we always use the element node number to designate what basis function we're using. Here in DL2, it's the element degree of freedom. Okay, so it will be the same as whatever index you're using in k-local. So this wouldn't be, for example, this wouldn't be a, this would be 3a plus I. And this wouldn't be b, it would be 3b plus j for DL2, okay? Sorry, not j, plus k. All right. Again, you'll need to use the elasticity tensor function that I've created before. And in order to use to get your determinant of j times the quadrature weights, you'll use fevalues.jxw for this particular quadrature point. Notice also that we aren't inputting the value of xi at the quadrature point. We're just inputting this index q, which is the tells you what quadrature point we're at in the loop, okay? Also to clarify, fevalues.shapegrad gives you a position vector. It's actually a DL2 point object, but you can think of it as a position vector. Or sorry, it's actually a first order tensor, which is very similar to a point in DL2, okay? If you want to use a particular component, which of course you will, you can use just these square brackets, I or J or whatever it may be, okay? So that should cover it for creating K-local. Let's move down to F-local. Now, we don't have a body force in this problem or any forcing function like that, but we do have a Neumann boundary condition. And so that will involve an integral over the Neumann boundary, okay? So let's write that out here. So for F local, A sub I, which again is the same as in our code, it will be 3a, or dim times a, since dim is equal to 3, plus I, is equal to this integral over a surface. And so I'm going to designate that with this partial omega. And I'll use T to specify its attraction. It's the Neumann condition, and it's for a particular element, okay? And we'll be integrating HI. So H is the traction, I is the component of the traction. The traction is a first order tensor or a vector, times NA. And again, it's a surface integral. All right. Okay, so let's go back to the code. You'll notice first, I'm doing a loop over the faces of the element, the current element. Of course, there are six faces. So we loop over those, and we're going to update FE face values for this, not only this current element, but also for the current face. That will put the quadrature points on the face itself that we're on. Now we're going to check to see if that face is at our Neumann boundary, okay? So this LM arrow face arrow center, that gives us a position vector at the center of the current face. And since I'm interested in the Z component, I use square brackets 2. Okay, so here in this if statement, I'm checking to see, is the point at the center of this face at the boundary Z equals 1, which is our Neumann boundary, okay? If it is, then I'll perform this surface integral, okay? If not, then I would just move on either to another face, and if none of those faces were Neumann faces, I'd move on to another element, and F local would be 0 for this element, okay? But once we have found that Neumann face and we are performing that surface integral, we'll move inside and loop over our face quadrature points. Okay, notice that, the number of face quadrature points. Here I've extracted for you the value of x, the x-coordinate of the current quadrature point. Okay, and I've done that using this FE face values dot quadrature point of q square bracket 0. If I wanted the z component, then I would just change that 0 to a 2. If I wanted y, I would change it to a 1. Okay, but then what you need to take that value of x and specify what the value of the traction vector h is at that quadrature point, okay? Now once you've done that, we'll move inside our loop over the nodes and the nodal degrees of freedom. Okay, and once inside there, you will, again, use this integral that we've written out on the board to define f local. Now you'll notice I am looping over all 8 nodes of the element, even though we're only doing a surface integral. However, the quadrature points themselves, D2 is placed on the correct surface, the correct face. So again, we are only integrating over the surface itself. All right, notice again, we'll be using FE face values to find the basis function value, okay? And you are still passing in the element degree of freedom. So that's 3 times a plus I, not just a, okay? And again, when you're finding j times w, the determinant of j times the quadrature weights, again, use FE face values, all right? Everything involved with the surface integral will be using FE face values, not FE values at all right? So once you've filled that in, you'll have F local created as well. And once you have F local and K local, assemble system will be very straightforward. It'll be exactly the same as the previous assignments, all right? Apply boundary conditions will be done in the same way. Again, you've already specified your Dirichlet boundary condition, fixing all degrees of freedom at z equals 0. And I'll scroll down a little bit more just to finish up quickly. Solve is exactly the same, and output results again is the same, outputting our displacement results as a .vtk file, which you can then open up using ParaViewer Visit to look at the displacements. All right, so that concludes this segment, and it concludes our discussion of the template for homework 4.